Muy buenos días, pues vamos a empezar este seminario del ICFEL último del año 2015 y tenemos hoy con nosotros a Nathaniel Barrett, que lleva una temporada en la Universidad de Navarra, actualmente es investigador en el grupo Mente-Cerebro del ICS, del Instituto Cultura y Sociedad, y trabaja en varias cosas. Sus intereses son fundamentalmente la axiología, cómo los valores pueden servir para entender la experiencia humana, la causalidad, y luego también, a lo largo de su carrera investigadora, ha cultivado siempre la interdisciplinariedad, que es uno de los rasgos distintivos de estos seminarios, en concreto en los estudios religiosos y en cómo tender puentes entre los diversos enfoques científicos y humanistas del saber humano. Nat Barrett ha hecho su carrera académica en las universidades de Yale, donde hizo los estudios de undergraduate. También tiene un máster de estudios teológicos por la Universidad de Harvard. Y su tesis doctoral la hizo en la Universidad de Boston. Creo que es la primera tesis interdisciplinar que combina filosofía de la religión y filosofía e historia de la ciencia. También pues ha publicado en las revistas más relevantes en estos ámbitos, revistas de fama internacional, en Topoi, en International Journal for the Philosophy of Religion, en Sophia, en Philosophy East and West, Journal for the American Academy of Religion, Religion, Brain and Behavior. Bueno, me parece que son señales o muestras más que suficientes para que nos pueda dar un seminario interdisciplinar como el que impartirá hoy. También para mí es como un día especialmente importante porque pues he tenido la suerte de trabajar con Nat durante algunos meses, algunos años ya creo, y le considero, aparte de un colega, pues es un amigo, y la verdad es que es una oportunidad de aprender de alguien que pues tiene mucho que ofrecer a esta comunidad académica, ¿no? Y desde luego para el CRIF. Bueno, hoy nos va a hablar sobre todo de la ciencia cognitiva de la religión. Es el título de su seminario. Os va a hacer una perspectiva amplia de este campo del saber humano. Hablará en inglés. Es un inglés que me parece que podemos seguir todos, aunque él entiende perfectamente español y luego en el debate las preguntas se pueden hacer en español. Bueno, sin más, I give the floor to you. So thanks for being here, and he'll speak about cognitive science of religion, history, key debates, and future prospects.
Okay.
Thank you, Nat.
Thank you very much, Don Javier, and thank you to the organizers of CRIF for the invitation to speak. I've attended many of these talks, and it's an honor to contribute. So today's talk is the cognitive science of religion. And when I was preparing this talk, I wasn't sure what the level of familiarity is with the field that goes by the name of cognitive science of religion. I'm assuming that maybe you've heard of this kind of research, but that you don't know much about it. So most of this talk is basically presented as an introduction and an overview. Here is an outline of the talk that I'm going to give, and one of the things that you'll see is that actually I spend a lot of time talking about responses to cognitive science of religion from other fields, also of the theoretical foundations of cognitive science that come from the field of cognitive science. We'll talk a little bit about that. The field cognitive science of religion has had a role in controversial arguments made by what are known as the new atheists. That's people like Richard Dawkins and Daniel Dennett. So we'll discuss that connection. Also, I want to talk about how the cognitive science of religion sort of reflects and also contributes to public discourse about religion in the modern world. And finally, I'll talk a little bit about how I think cognitive science of religion might be improved by a new model, but only briefly. So this is really an overview from 30,000 feet, as we say, but with special attention not just to the specific context, I mean the content of cognitive science of religion, but to its context. Because I think that understanding how to place cognitive science within a larger intellectual and historical context is very important to how we respond or participate in this research. So to begin, this is just the bare bones, the basics of what cognitive science of religion is. Just to define it, it's a field of research that applies theories and concepts of cognitive science to explain religious thought and behavior. That doesn't tell you much, but I think that's the essence of it. The participants, the main participants, are anthropologists. Anthropologists have played a especially prominent role in the formation of the field, but also psychologists participate, philosophers, and scholars of religion. That is, participants from the field known as religious studies or the study of religion, which is an interdisciplinary, largely humanistic field. Methods are various. Ethnographic observation, surveys, interviews, brain imaging studies, laboratory experiments, and computer simulations, and I'm sure there are many more. So it's a very, methodologically, it's a very diverse field. History, I won't go through all of this, but just briefly, it's a young field. It emerged in the 1990s, although it has important antecedents that are much older than that. But it's now rather well established because there are research centers around the world devoted to the support of cognitive science of religion. These include one institute at the Queen's University Belfast in Denmark. There's a program for research in Boston, Massachusetts, the Institute for Biocultural Study of Religion, and the Center for Human Evolution, Cognition, Culture at the University of British Columbia, just to name a few. There are many more. Those are a few of the most prominent. And also, within the last 10 years, there's been established an international society. These are all the marks of an established academic field. It has centers of research. It has an organization of scholars and conferences. And finally, it has publications. It has journals where it disseminates its work. Cognitive science of religion has been published in a number of different kinds of journals because it's a kind of interdisciplinary program. So it's published in religious studies journals, anthropology, cognitive science. Especially important is the Journal of Cognition and Culture. And recently, within just the last 5 years or so, two journals that are devoted to the cognitive science of religion have been established. That's Religion, Brain, and Behavior and Journal for the Cognitive Science of Religion. So this gives you the bare bones. It doesn't tell you much about the content, but this is how you might identify the cognitive science of religion as an academic field. So it's important that I think when you first start thinking about the cognitive science of religion, I think one of the most important things is to realize is that it has a certain coherence as a field. It has a theoretical basis that is more or less widely shared by its participants. It has an empirical orientation. It has an explanatory agenda. And when scientific research shares all of these things and coalesces in this way, sometimes we call it a paradigm or a research program. And within the field, a lot of commentators have taken to calling this sort of coherent program the standard model. It's a term that's used often in the literature. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about the standard model of cognitive science of religion. And this will put some flesh on the bare bones definition that I just gave. So, and most of my talk is concerned with the standard model of cognitive science of religion. Because, in fact, I'm not sure if there is research that is explicitly cognitive science-oriented that is other than the standard model. The standard model more or less dominates the field right now. So, first of all, its goal is to explain the religion. This is in their own words. They describe it as an explanatory enterprise, and they distinguish cognitive science of religion from fields of religious studies, largely humanistic fields of religious studies, that have been engaged in what they call largely interpretive or descriptive kinds of research. right? So they tend to contrast cognitive science with what's called the thick descriptive work of anthropologists like Clifford Geertz, right? People who go to the field and they spend some time with a particular religious culture, and then they write up articles and books that give very rich interpretive descriptions. You might say that the cognitive science of religion defines itself over and against a Verstehen approach to religious studies, which is dominant in the humanistic disciplines, right? Another way to define the cognitive science of religion, which I have found especially useful, and I've lifted this quote from a text by one of the founding members of the field, Lawson, and what he says is this: whatever it takes to explain how minds work generally will be sufficient to explain how religious minds work. And he means all religious minds, Christian, Buddhist, Taoist, Hindu, Muslim, you name it, right? I've called this Lawson's principle because I think it's a very elegant way of defining the starting point of the cognitive science of religion. And I think it's very helpful because it's vague. It doesn't actually say how we think minds work generally. But the initial sort of basic premise or thesis of the field is that if we have a theory about how they work in general, we can apply that to religious minds and understand how they work, right? Next, understanding the origin, composition, and persistence of religion in the supernatural beings it features requires an understanding of the evolved mind. This is basically just a slightly more elaborated version of Lawson's principle, right? And I've put it up there to show you another example of the basic thesis of the field, right? But it shows that in terms of explanatory goals, cognitive science, religion is interested in the origin of religion. That's very important. But also in the reasons for its persistence. One of the sort of unspoken or sometimes spoken premises of the field is, from the scientific point of view, religion seems to persist despite contrary evidence. That's one of their premises that they often discuss when introducing the work. And one of the things that they're interested to explain is, why is that? Right. So you might say the explananda for cognitive science of religion are widely recurring patterns of religious belief and behavior. This is important because cognitive science and religion is not so much interested in individual kinds of experience or practice. They're interested in the broadest patterns. They don't claim to be studying universal features, but they do focus on widely recurring patterns of belief and behavior, right? And if they can establish that those patterns exist, then they have something to explain, right? And what do they explain it with? Universal features of the human mind, plus, in some cases, evolutionary accounts of these features, as adaptations in our ancestral environment. This is the evolutionary side of the cognitive science of religion, which is very important, although I'll be talking less about it today. Another important part of the standard model is that the explanatory features of the human mind are not specifically religious. They are not emotional or spiritual capacities or needs that the human mind has. Rather, and here's a statement by two other of its founding figures: religion is rather a range of effects of the way our brains are constructed, right? Constructed for everyday cognitive purposes, right? You might say that they think of religion in the standard model, they think of it as a side effect of the way the human brain is constructed. The defining and foundational premise of cognitive science approach is that the mechanisms by means of which humans learn, think, perceive, remember, and so on affect the content of their thoughts and behavior. So because we have a certain set of structures that constitute the human mind, those structures constrain the way we think about everything, right? And that would include religion as well, but also other things. So really the cognitive science of religion sees itself as the application of general cognitive science knowledge to a specific part of human thought and behavior. Here is a further thesis which is very important. Mind is a collection of domain-specific information processing systems. So this is an additional part of the cognitive science religion standard model. It is not essential to the field, but it is so common as to be basically part of its theoretical foundation. And I'll have a lot more to say about it in a second. So basically, continuing with a quote from Laidlaw and Whitehouse, the brain is understood to be a complex set of functioning mechanisms of information processing. The outputs depend on the inputs, but also on the mechanisms that come in between. So now that was a rather specific sort of definition of the standard model. Now let's step back a little bit and consider some of the background tenets or premises of the field. So naturalism. Obviously, naturalism is a part of the cognitive science of religion and its approach to religion. In that sense, it shares, it's part of a long tradition of naturalistic understandings of religion that go back at least as far as David Hume, if not even further to Lucretius. It's part of a very broad tradition of naturalistic understandings of religion. One of the things I think it's important to understand is that there are many varieties of naturalism today. I cannot stress that point enough. Many varieties of naturalism. And it is not clear which, if any, deserve the sort of additional qualification, scientific naturalism. So, for instance, a physicalist version of naturalism, maybe if you're familiar with Anglo-American philosophy and its understanding of naturalism, physicalism is a common understanding of naturalism, but it is not the only one. And depending on how you understand science, it may or may not be a necessary premise for scientific research. This is a very important sort of caveat to have in mind. A rejection of the sui generis nature of religion. Sui generis nature, that's a common way of understanding religion in the last century, especially within the field of religious studies. That is, that religion cannot be understood or explained except in relation to religious kinds of causes and reasons. Right? In fact, however, again, like naturalism, there are many different ways of understanding that claim. And whether cognitive science of religion needs to reject all of them, I think, should be an open question. Right. Another part of the standard premise or tenets of standard model of cognitive science of religion is that the sine qua non of religion is belief in supernatural agents. Right. Most of the literature tends, if it does define religion, to focus on belief in supernatural agents of some kind. They think this is what identifies religion as such. We will have more to say about what it means, what this concept of belief means. Computational theory of mind, that's already been mentioned, and I'm about to talk about it further. So for now, I'll just move on, but I think it's crucial to understand how the computational foundation of cognitive science constrains and directs the cognitive science of religion. It's a theoretical approach, and how that directs the work done in the field is it is the crucial question to ask. Main causes of religious belief are unconscious. That is a common assumption. It has a lot to do with the computational theory of mind. Right, that there are these unconscious inferential mechanisms which constrain our thought, and those are the main drivers of religiosity, or among them. Falsehood of religious belief. This is a question mark. Is it a premise of the cognitive science of religion that religious belief is false? Many would say no, but it is clear that in a lot of the literature, that is basically more or less stated as a premise, right? And part of the explanatory work that cognitive science of religion wants to do is understand why false beliefs are so prevalent in the human species, right? Now, many of you may find that a highly objectionable starting point for a science of religion, but it's at least, if not dominant, it's at least shared by maybe a majority of the practitioners, although there are very important exceptions. And perhaps as the field matures, it will consider this premise to be something less important to its work. That remains to be seen. A lot of these sort of basic tenets have come from an outline which you can find referred to in the bibliography. Theoretical foundations. Now, this is the part that happens to interest me the most, right? Because I do a lot of work in philosophy of mind and cognitive science generally. I'm very interested in the theoretical foundations of cognitive science of religion that come from the broader field of cognitive science. So the computational theory of mind, I've already told you several times, is at the center. How can we define that? Computational accounts assume that we can model our cognitive processes and specify the products that these processes generate, much like we specify mathematical operations, right? So that's a very clear, straightforward understanding of what it means to have a computational theory of mind. Basically, you think that the mind can be modeled much in the way of mathematical operations, right? Mind is a problem-solving machine. This is a less commonly stated, but I think very important premise of the computational theory, that what the mind does is solve problems, right? And its problems can be analyzed into functional units which can be given algorithmic descriptions. So this basically summarizes a very famous and influential approach developed by the cognitive scientist David Marr in his book on vision. So the goal of a lot of computational cognitive science is to try to understand what problems the mind is solving, and then break those problem downs into their subcomponent tasks, and then further down into their, you might say, most basic functional units, which are algorithms, basically. Another really important, I would say, tenet or premise of the field of cognitive science in general, but especially of the kind that influences cognitive science of religion, is something called the poverty of the stimulus. And this argument is most famously credited to Noam Chomsky, who's basically one of the founders of cognitive science as it exists today. He's one of the participants in the so-called cognitive revolution of the 1950s. Right? And he has defended the poverty of stimulus argument in several subsequent publications. But I think that it basically forms the background or framework of most cognitive science work in the last half century. Basically, what the poverty of stimulus thesis says is that solutions to most cognitive problems are underdetermined by structures of the environment. Right? The prototypical case is language. How do children learn language? So Chomsky famously argued many decades ago that the environment in which children learn language, that is the social environment of their caregivers and so forth, does not give them enough information to actually learn their language. It doesn't give them information about correct usage, especially. And so he argued, therefore, children must have that information innately, right? What he called in the form of something like deep grammar, right? Because it's not in the environment. But this sort of thesis of the poverty of stimulus has been generalized to take care of many problems that human cognitive systems handle on a regular basis. And so it's a sort of a very common pattern of thought is that this complicated problem cannot be solved with the information given in the environment. The environment is too noisy, it's too messy, it's not structured enough, and so our minds must come equipped with the information needed. It's very important. Modularity, if you know something about cognitive science of the last 25 years or 30 years or more, you know that modularity is one of its central theses. It's usually introduced by saying that the mind is not a general information processor. I don't know when the last time someone argued that it was, but they always introduce modularity as if it's fighting against this other alternative. But modularity is basically the idea that the brain is a collection of processing systems, each of which has its own kind of task. It is not clear how those processing systems have to be broken down further into subsystems and so on further, but the idea is that the brain at least has some set of genetically specified information processing systems that work more or less independently of each other, although they may receive input from one another, right, or from the senses. So a typical example is, do we have a module that tells us how to process that handles the processing of information about other people, especially their intentions? And this module would be called the theory of mind module. It's one of the most commonly studied theoretical entities in cognitive science. The idea is that maybe autism people lack a theory of mind module, or it's impaired in some way. So modularity is a key strategy, I should say, to most cognitive science. Finally, evolutionary psychology is kind of a branch of cognitive science that took off, especially in the 90s, not coincidentally at the same time that the cognitive science religion took off. And it basically is built on a modular understanding of the mind, but with the additional premise that domain-specific modules can be explained as adaptations in our ancestral environment. And this is important because what was adaptive in our ancestral environment may not be adaptive today. So to take a very common example, the taste that we have for sugar in fatty foods was probably highly adaptive in our ancestral environment when food resources were scarce, but it's not adaptive in a modern industrial society where you can have as much sugar and fat as you want, right? So now let's turn to specific concepts and theories of cognitive science of religion. One of the main foci of cognitive science of religion research is on what's taken to be a very powerful anthropomorphizing tendency of the human mind. And that's been sort of elevated to the status of a module. We have a module that sort of is responsible for that tendency. It's called the hyperactive agency detection device. But basically, the idea is the human mind exhibits a strong predilection to interpret ambiguous information in anthropomorphic terms. And the idea is that there's a reason for that. There's an evolutionary reason why we tend to anthropomorphize information in the environment. It had some kind of survival value in our ancestral environment. But it's left a major sort of mark on human cognition, this anthropomorphizing tendency. And most cognitive scientists feel that this is one of the basically explanatory foundations of religion, is this anthropomorphizing tendency. Minimally counterintuitive ideas. This is something that was developed out of the work of a very important precursor or influence on cognitive science of religion, which is the French anthropologist Dan Sperber's work on the epidemiology of religious ideas. Epidemiology is the study of how diseases are transmitted, and basically thought that ideas should be thought of as more or less contagious in the same manner. And the anthropologist Pascal Boyer took that idea and said probably what makes certain ideas really contagious is that they tweak, meaning they violate in certain select respects the expectations of our inferential systems, our modules, but only in certain ways. That's what tweaking means. So for instance, a ghost is just like a person, except that it's transparent and it can walk through walls and so forth, right? But in other respects, it should obey all of our expectations with regard to persons, that is, in terms of continuity of personality, memory, and so forth, right? So the idea is a ghost is a minimally counterintuitive idea according to our innate processing modules. Minimally counterintuitive. Right? It does a few things that we don't expect, but otherwise it behaves as a person. And the idea is that those kinds of ideas are cognitively optimal, because they're interesting to us, but they're also easy to remember. And so the idea is that certain kinds of ideas get passed on and transmitted and basically reproduce themselves through culture because they are minimally counterintuitive. And this is supposed to explain, in Boyer's view, why certain religious ideas are pervasive and others are not. Right? This is his idea. Naturalness of religion thesis, a lot of cognitive science of religion contributes to this. This is not just one theory. It's sort of like a conclusion that draws from a lot of different work. And this is the idea that given the natural predispositions of our cognitive architecture, religious ideas, that is especially supernatural agent concepts, arise spontaneously, and they are very easy for us to think with and about. So there's something about religious ideas, they fit well with the structure of the human mind. Theological incorrectness, this is something that I'm sure a lot of you would be interested in, who have to sort of, who are involved in the instruction of theology. They claim that there is a measurable distinction between explicit statements of religious belief and default ways of thinking about religious ideas. The most prominent example is that Orthodox theological tradition, not just in Christianity, but in many different traditions, puts lots of restrictions on the anthropomorphic features of God. Right? God is not supposed to be thought of as just like a person who's just bigger and more powerful and more knowledgeable. Right? Yet, cognitive scientists claim even people who know that and are able to report that knowledge of theological correctness, when it comes time for them to reason or think about God in a specific situation, they tend to revert to a very anthropomorphic notion of God. So they sort of switch to a default mode. This is something that's been widely studied. Also, here's a thesis that you might find rather objectionable, but it's important in the evolutionary theory. This has to do with the cost puzzle of evolution, of religious belief. So given, as some scientists accept, that the susceptibility to religious belief constitutes a tendency to err about the world, so given that premise, religion presents an evolutionary cost puzzle. And the costliness of religion needs to be explained, because usually natural selection doesn't let us get away with a systematic tendency to err about the world, if that's the case. But they say perhaps it's compensated for by strong pro-social effects. So this is one of the most important areas of cognitive science of religion now, has to do with religion and pro-sociality. What is the relationship between the religiousness of the human species and the unique social characteristics of the human species? And a lot of people think that there is a very deep connection there. And finally, one of the more influential or prominent theories about the evolution of religion, which addresses this problem, is the costly signaling theory, which says that the costliness of religion is itself adaptive, that is, rather than just compensated by something else, the costliness itself is adaptive if religiosity signals to other members of your group your sincere commitment to that group. It signals honesty. This is called costly signaling theory. It's been developed by Richard Sosis, among others. So let's talk about some of the data that's related to these concepts and theories, but also exists more or less independently of them. There have been a lot of studies on children and the innateness of religion, or these are ideas about teleology, about agency and purpose. And the conclusion that has been drawn is that the children seem to be intuitive theists, meaning that they have sort of an innate disposition to think about the world in ways that are either theist or conducive to theism. The work there that's most prominently featured is by Deborah Kellerman. Anthropomorphism and theological incorrectness, I've already talked about this, so I'll move through it pretty quickly. I just want to point out that there has been an ethnographic study that applied the sort of theoretical model of cognitive science to understand why in this Brazilian spiritualist movement the practitioners systematically differed from the leaders in their explanations of spirit possession. And the idea was that the practitioners gravitate naturally towards the default modes of thinking about religious ideas, while the leaders tend to uphold the stricter, theologically correct, you might say, beliefs, which are harder for the mind to maintain because they don't quite fit with our natural tendencies. Religion and pro-social effects, I said that I think this is perhaps one of the most important areas of research in cognitive science and psychology of religion now and probably in the future. Related to the work of costly signaling, Sosis and others have compared religious and secular communes, both in history in the United States, but also in Israel. You don't know about these communes that are called kibbutzes, and some are religious and some are not. And he studied and compared them and found that religious kibbutzes tended to last a lot longer than secular kibbutzes. And the idea is that the religiosity has a pro-social effect, has a binding effect, which keeps these communes together. Here's one that's very close to home. There was a study conducted in the province of Soria, in the village of San Pedro Manrique. There's a fire-walking ritual there. And a study was conducted a few years ago that found that the heart rates of firewalkers were synchronized with one another and also partially synchronized with related spectators, that is, spectators who knew them. And this is supposed to be perhaps a mechanism, another sign that religion is a mechanism of social bonding. That's a very old theory in religious studies. It goes back at least as far as Durkheim, but it's being given new sort of empirical flesh with cognitive science studies like this one. Another famous study shows that priming subjects with God concepts increases their generosity towards others in simple economic games. You'll find all of these references, by the way, are in the reference sheet that I handed out. Finally, another very important area of research has to do with religion and prejudice and aggression. This is sort of goes along with the religion and pro-sociality studies because it's now a problem how to tease apart the pro-social aspect of religiosity from what seems to be also its ties to prejudice and aggression towards members of the out-group, you might say. Okay. So now let's get into some of the controversy and polemics that has been associated with the cognitive science of religion. Maybe some of you have heard something of these books. Daniel Dennett, Breaking the Spell, Richard Dawkins, The God Delusion. They made a big splash almost 10 years ago when they came out, and along with other books, they became labeled as part of a new atheism movement, which is a very aggressive kind of argument against religion. Especially Daniel Dennett made a lot of arguments based on the kinds of theories that have come out of the cognitive science of religion. Of course, he added his own thought. He's a brilliant philosopher, so there's a lot in his book that is his own thinking, of course. It wasn't just a summary of the field. And so the question is, what does the cognitive science of religion have to do with new atheist controversy and so forth? One thing that's important to realize is that there was some criticism from scientists about these works as overreaching in their rhetoric or as perhaps even misrepresenting the field. So a couple important examples, Armin Geertz, who directs one of the cognitive science research programs in Denmark wrote an article called How Not to Do the Cognitive Science of Religion Today. And that's specifically with respect to Dennett's book. So he took Dennett to task for what he saw was a sort of a misrepresentation of the field and also an overly polemical style, which need not be a part of what the field does. Jonathan Haidt, I'm not sure if you know his work. He does fascinating research on moral psychology. And he published an interesting article that examined the arguments of Dawkins and maybe Dennett as well as examples of certain kinds of patterns of human thought, and also took them to task for misrepresenting or misunderstanding religious thought as he understands it. On the other hand, it still is an open question whether cognitive science of religion has an anti-religious agenda. If you read certain leading publications, prominent publications by leading figures such as Pascal Boyer, Scott Atran, and Jesse Baring, it's fairly clear that they think of their work as grounds for unbelief. If they do not draw the conclusion explicitly, they make it abundantly clear in the language that they use. And some of them in conferences have expressed a desire to wipe out religion, and they're hoping that cognitive science will help to do that. But those opinions are not shared by everyone. And importantly, we'll talk in a moment, they're not shared by some of the leaders of the field. So this is, in some senses, still an open question. Again, it's also important to realize that some cognitive scientists begin with the premise, explicitly states the falsity of religious belief, because that's part of what they want to explain. They consider that part of what needs to be explained, right? So, it's a complicated question. Another question which is interesting is, does it matter what scientists believe? There is an ethics of science which basically says that the agenda, the personal ideological agenda of a scientist should be, in most cases, if the science is decent, it should be separated from the theory, from the evaluation of their theory and data and so forth, right? Because if you start to sort of police science, you know, sort of requiring some kind of strict ideological purity, you'll find that a lot of very good science fails that test. And part of what's important about science is learning how to separate some of these factors from the evaluation of science, right? And so likewise, some scientists participate who are Christian, and maybe they think of their work as contributing to Christian faith, but that aspect of their research should be independent of the evaluation, the theories and arguments that they make. And likewise, perhaps in this case, as cognitive science of religion matures, this aspect of it should be less important, or at least it can be separated, right? The main task is to evaluate it qua science. At least that's an ideal. So let's look at responses from theology and philosophy, especially because of the new atheist arguments, but also, I think, even without the new atheist polemics, many of the claims warrant a response from theology. So there has been quite a bit of literature devoted to responding to the cognitive science of religion as a potential threat to religious belief, right? Does it undermine religious faith? Right? And here's a basic summary of the kinds of responses that have been offered by theologians and philosophers of religion. One kind of response, and I'm just citing some examples, is that CSR explanations are valid as far as they go, but they're incomplete. That's a very common argument made. It's made, someone you might know, Nancy Murphy, made an argument to that extent. She said, maybe there is something to criticize about the field, but even without criticizing it, she wants to point out that it has limited explanatory reach. Right? Another kind of response is that CSR explanations do not by themselves constitute grounds for unbelief, unless they are paired with some other metaphysical thesis, like naturalism, metaphysical naturalism, I should say. Plantinga is famous for arguing against the naturalistic foundations of science as not intrinsic to science as such, right? He's famous for making those arguments, but many others have made similar arguments specifically with respect to the cognitive science of religion, saying that it explains what it explains, but if you want to take it as an argument against belief, you have to add to it a commitment to metaphysical naturalism, and metaphysical naturalism is not properly a part of science, they claim. Right? That's a common response. Another very important and prominent is that CSR explanations are consistent with the existence of God. So who makes this argument? Most famously, Justin Barrett, no relation. Justin Barrett is one of the leaders, one of the founders of the cognitive science of religion. He's actually quite a young man still, but he's been extraordinarily influential in the formulation of its key theories, but also he's conducted a lot of empirical research. His training is as a psychologist. He's also a Christian, and he's very explicit about that. I believe he belongs to the evangelical variety of Protestant Christianity. And he has argued in his books that a brain that is, let's put it crudely, that is more or less hardwired for religious belief is consistent with a loving creator God. It's basically saying, just because I was evolved to be susceptible to belief in God doesn't mean that God does not exist. In fact, perhaps I would expect God to design humans this way, right? That's an argument that he makes. And so he's often held up as an example of why cognitive science of religion, especially the standard model, its computational theory, and all of the different aspects that I outlined, does not require atheism as part of its premises. He's held up as an example whether he really is more than a token, I'm not sure, but he is an important figure for sure. Responses from religious studies. So religious studies is a field that doesn't exist as such in Spain, but it's very important in the United States and in England and maybe in some other countries of Europe. It's a collection of humanistic disciplines like sociology of religion, a history of religion. It includes philosophy of religion in some forms. It also sometimes includes theology. And it's important to realize that the response of religious studies scholars has been very different in general from the response of theologians and philosophers of religion. Because notice that theologians and philosophers, as I've sort of characterized their responses just now, they haven't concerned themselves so much with the explanations of CSR in themselves. They've just sought to sort of limit their reach or their force, right? But they haven't objected to the kinds of explanations that are being given. Whereas the tendency in religious studies is very different. They object to the kinds of explanations offered, right? So they think that the focus on belief in supernatural agents reflects a modern Western cultural bias, maybe even a Protestant bias. It's a very specific way of thinking about what religion is, right? More specifically, perhaps, the understanding of what it means to believe is extremely simplistic. It's overly rationalistic, in quotation marks. That means a kind of a style of thinking rather than being rational or irrational. And also, it's divorced from the religious life. It's a mere proposition about the world. And I'll have more to say about that in a second. And thirdly, CCR neglects the importance of practice, material culture, experience, and other aspects of religion. Several people have made this complaint. And so I would say overall, the complaint from religious studies is that the cognitive science of religion is an impoverished and overly simplistic way of understanding religion, right? Now, a lot of these claims have been countered within the field, and it's important to realize the cognitive science of religion is rapidly evolving and taking on new dimensions in such a way that it's not as it's harder to stereotype in terms of the standard model now as it was in the past. So finally, so we're reaching the end. How does the cognitive science of religion reflect and inform modern discourse about religion? This is related to some of the critiques just made. And we could spend a lot of time talking about this, but I thought I would just use a single quote to sort of illustrate what is often overlooked. It's a kind of bias that informs the discipline. This comes from a famous historian of religion who taught at Harvard for much of the latter part of the 20th century. He had a big influence on religious studies in previous decades. And he published some works in the 70s and 80s about the history of belief. And this is a quote from that. He says, "The affirmation, 'I believe in God,' used to mean..." So this work is about how our understanding of what belief is has changed in the modern world, right? So it used to mean, "Given the reality of God as a fact of the universe, I hereby pledge to him my heart and soul. I committedly opt to live in loyalty to him. I offer my life to be judged by him, trusting his mercy." So that's what belief used to mean. He says, "Today the statement may be taken by some as meaning, 'Given the uncertainty as to whether there be a God or not, as a fact of modern life, I announce that my opinion is yes. I judge God to be existent.' And to say that so-and-so believes in God may mean the idea of God is a part of the furniture of that man's mind." Right? Now, if you think about it, at least in its sort of prototypical standard form, the cognitive science of religion studies this. It studies the phenomenon of the idea of God being part of the furniture of the human mind in general, not just a person's mind, but it sort of fits well with the furniture of human minds. But it studies just this notion of belief, sort of like a linguistic proposition about the world concerning the existence of a deity or a supernatural agent that is difficult, if not impossible, to confirm empirically, right? Compare that with this notion of belief, which is largely not studied by cognitive science of religion. Right? It's not of particular interest to it at this point in time. I think that's a good way to get a handle on what has been going on in the cognitive science of religion. No one should say that belief is not an important part of religiosity, and it always has been. But there is something peculiar about religious belief in the modern world. And a lot of historians and theologians, sociologists, have pointed this out. I mean, it has to do with secularity. It has to do, for some people, with the influence of Protestantism. It has to do with the influence of scientific rationality. There are many forces, perhaps at work, that have sort of distilled religiosity into intellectual assent to a proposition about the world. Right? Now, the thing about cognitive science of religion is that they respond, they say, "But are you saying that people don't believe?" Because we go out and we test, we ask questions, we have ways of measuring, and we get data. Well, of course, if you're going to go out and ask people about beliefs, you're going to come out back with data, right, about what they believe and so forth. But if you think about lots of ordinary practitioners and lots of different traditions, they are not thinking, especially some of the most devoted practitioners, they are not often thinking about what they believe in the midst of devotion. They are much more interested in the kind of relationship they have with God or with whatever the object of their devotion is, right? They're interested in the role that relationship plays in their life and so forth. But believing in it is, you could say, it's not really even a premise because it's embedded in that life, right? And some people, surely not anyone in this room, but some people are not really sure what they believe, even though they are very actively religious, because they don't think about it that often. If you ask a lot of people about certain aspects of doctrine, they're going to give you an answer, but whether that's really that informs their religious life is another question. This is partly something that cognitive science is interested in, is the difference between explicitly stated belief and how religious ideas function and so forth. But I think that they've just scratched the surface in terms of what belief really is. So that's one possible entryway into thinking about cognitive science relates to a much wider phenomenon, which is thinking about religion only in terms of creedal statements, basically. Right. So, prospects for a new model. One of the things that's important is, as I've stressed repeatedly, is that the cognitive science of religion has very specific theoretical foundations which come from cognitive science, but especially cognitive science of the past three decades or four decades or so. Those ideas and concepts and theories, they're still current, but the landscape of cognitive theory has changed a lot, especially in the last 25 years. Whether we're witnessing another cognitive revolution, it's too early to say. But I'm going to tell you about some movements or different sort of strands of research which have changed this landscape of cognitive theory. One is what is known as the embodied turn and the arrival of a non-computational paradigm of cognitive science research called inactive theory of cognition. This is one of many examples of the embodied turn. Cognitive scientists and philosophers are still debating what the embodied turn means, and only some of them, probably a minority, believe that it means the abandonment of computational theory. Nevertheless, it has radically changed what we understand as cognitive theory today, and it's not clear how that's reflected in the cognitive science of religion. Sometimes it takes years for cutting-edge theoretical developments to make their way into fields of research that apply, that are more applied. So computational theory is no longer the only game in town. Actually, it was never the only game in town. But it's been harder to claim in recent years that it's the only cognitive theory really up and running in cognitive science. Ecological psychology has been around for decades. It's one of the reasons why cognitive science has never been only computational, but it's been gaining steam in recent years. And one of the important aspects of ecological psychology, it's very important to note, is that it completely contradicts the thesis of the poverty of the stimulus. It starts with an entirely different premise. It starts with the premise that the environment is richly structured and can provide all kinds of information for perception, action, and cognition, especially if the organism is moving and creating flows of stimulation by its movement through the environment. So it's a very different way of approaching the whole question of cognition. Neurodynamics, that's just a sort of a catch-all term for a lot of different kinds of studies on global connectivity and dynamics of the brain. One of the implications of this research is that the functional role of brain structures depends on transient patterns of global connectivity, and that implies that there are no domain-specific modules, right? So it might be very bad news for one of the pillars of the cognitive science of religion. Developmental systems, the field called EvoDevo, which is evolutionary developmental biology, has changed the way we think about evolution a lot, and genetics and so forth. And that means that the premises of evolutionary psychology, one of the major influences on standard model of cognitive science of religion, have been under attack in the last 15 years or more. Right? So all this is to say that The theoretical foundations of the standard model, that is not to say all of cognitives, but the standard model have showed a lot of cracks recently, and they may be crumbling. Okay, so concluding remarks. I think this is important. For better or worse, whatever theoretical foundations it has, the cognitive science of religion is here to stay. I could elaborate on why that's the case. I think there are a number of reasons why. I think it actually has a constructive role to play in discourse about religion, although maybe it's not playing that role quite yet. But I think for a lot of other reasons as well, it's not going anywhere. It's just a question of what form it's going to take. Right? It has established centers now, it has organizations, it has journals, it has momentum. It is here to stay. This is a sort of an observation that comes from philosophy of science. I didn't cite it, but it's informed by famous historian philosopher of science, Imre Lakatos. And that is that basically research programs, once they're really up and running, they are rarely displaced or revised because of problems they have. Empirically, they are more often displaced. I mean, they are rarely abandoned. So what happens is that they are usually displaced by another program, or they are revised. Right. A lot of the complaints about cognitive science theory make the mistake of sort of assuming that science operates according to sort of a naive falsificationist sort of method, which means that if science is not very convincing, right? If it doesn't seem to work very well, well, then we just get rid of it. But that's really not how science works. Science needs comparison between theories really to advance. And I would say, maybe you think this is too strong, but comparison with a superior theory is the only effective criticism of scientific research. Matt Hatter, I mean, some of these ideas, I haven't criticized them myself, but some of these ideas of cognitive science research to me appear to be highly dubious, like the hyperactive agency detection device. I think it's a very dubious idea and it explains nothing. But if you want to actually make progress and get rid of that idea, you have to come up with a better way of explaining patterns of anthropomorphism and so forth, right? So you have to sort of displace it rather than just say, that's a lousy idea, it doesn't explain anything, right? The time is ripe for a non-computational approach to CSR. I think this is good news. I think the fact that cognitive science has changed a lot means that it's time for the cognitive science of religion to reflect on how it should change or at least diversify as a result. Also, it's important to realize that there is a large and growing body of empirical data on religion that just cannot be ignored. There are urgent questions posed by religious violence and other issues related to religion in the modern world. And people want, good, hard evidence that enables them to deal with these issues. And that's unavoidable, and it's a good thing. That data must be gathered and it must be interpreted somehow, right? The data about religion and violence, or religion and aggression, or religion and pro-sociality, it's going to be interpreted with the best theoretical models we have available, right? And if those models aren't very good, or if you don't think that they're very good, well, then there need to be better ones. But the data has to be interpreted. It's rather urgent. Also, this is a more subtle issue, but the generation of data about religion depends in part on the theoretical approach, right? The kinds of questions that you're asking in a survey influence the kinds of answers you get. You all know about this, right? And a lot of cognitive science of religion depends on interviews and surveys and so forth. So we need theoretical nuance and sophistication if we're going to have really good data. It's not just that the data is there and then we bring our theories to interpret it, but the theories actually participate in the manufacture of data. Finally, I think this is important to recognize. I think probably we all agree, but sometimes it helps to state it outright. Whatever the limits of a scientific or naturalistic understanding of religion, all of us, that is, theists, atheists, agnostics, none of the above, everyone should be concerned to have the most adequate scientific understanding of religion possible. Right? Maybe you feel very strongly that it can only go so far, as so many of the theologians and philosophers of religion have claimed. But as far as it goes, you want it to be good. Right? And my complaint with theologians and philosophers who have reacted to the field is that they have been concerned themselves more with basically creating a barrier or a line and saying, well, the scientific explanations won't cross that line. But whatever they do on the other side of that line is fine with us. I think this is not the right response. I think that a more active effort in contributing to better theories and the collection of data is important. Related to this, I would say beware of scorched earth defenses against naturalism. Scorched earth is, I don't know if you know that phrase, but in English it refers to this tactic when you're being attacked by an army, you basically retreat and burn all the crops and land. The Russians did this when Napoleon invaded France. I mean, when Napoleon invaded Russia, the Russians adopted a scorched earth strategy. I think that theologians and philosophers of religion sometimes adopt something like a scorched earth defense against naturalism, which means they basically abandon the scientific field to the most impoverished form of naturalist discourse possible because it's easier for them to say that that form of discourse is limited with respect to what it can say about religion. See? In other words, sometimes I feel that in response to naturalistic discourse, rather than wanting to improve that naturalistic discourse, qua naturalistic discourse, they actually like it to be as barren as possible because it's easy to refute. I think that that is a strategical error. I don't think it's good for society in general to allow naturalist discourse to remain so impoverished. Why? Because scientific knowledge, whether we agree with this or not, is going to play an important role, and maybe an increasingly public role, in public discourse about religion. Especially in a world in which terrorist attacks are linked with religious belief, people are going to be turning more and more for answers to cognitive science of religion, and they already have been turning. Finally, I mean, there are ways in which religious practitioners, theologians, philosophers of religion, scholars of religion, people who know religion from a different perspective, can contribute to a very different style of cognitive science of religion, one that emphasizes more practice, and it could be that this form of cognitive science is less divisive in its premises and more constructive. And that about finishes it. Thank you.
¿Alguien quiere intervenir? Pedir la palabra. Yo, mientras, para romper el hielo, tengo una pregunta. Es sobre la metodología de la Cognitive Science of Religion. Tengo la impresión de estar en el problema de ad oscurum per obscurius. You know what that means. So you're trying to understand something which is very, very dark,
right,
through something which is darker. Y digo esto porque se ha hablado de entender las causas del pensamiento religioso que a veces son inconscientes.
Sí.
Pero para eso tendríamos que saber qué es la conciencia desde el punto de vista de la cognitive science.
Yeah.
¿Tenemos bases epistémicas fuertes para seguir ese camino metodológico? They claim they have. But what do you think?
It's about their claims about unconscious
mechanisms. La metodología, yeah, teniendo en cuenta el problema de, yeah, la consciencia. ¿Qué es consciente, qué es inconsciente?
Right. And what about the existence of these unconscious mechanisms, which has never been established, right? They are not observable entities of science. They are theoretical entities, right? But there is the assumption, I believe, that eventually this modular way of understanding the mind is going to be backed up by neuroscience. But it has not been. And in fact, I think that cutting-edge research increasingly calls it into question. And so that is a great irony that Javier has pointed out, that in an effort to explain something obscure, they have relied on a kind of explanation that invokes a theoretical entity, these domain-specific modules, which are in themselves rather obscure. But they sound, they have a very scientific sort of sounding title. I mean, my favorite is the hyperactive agency detection device. I mean, it sounds sounds very technical. This is not an entity that's being studied by any neuroscientist that I know of. It's a hypothesis that perhaps an anthropomorphizing tendency was so important in our ancestral environment because, and these are the kinds of arguments that are offered quite regularly, because if there was sort of a sound in the bushes, this is, you know, many hundreds of thousands of years ago, and we weren't sure what that noise in the bushes was, it was better for us to infer like that there was some agent, perhaps a hostile agent, a member of an enemy tribe or a predator, and that we should run or prepare to fight, right? So we had a kind of a hair trigger instinct to infer that there were agents all around us because it protected us from sudden attack, right? Now, this is an interesting theory, but if you start taking it seriously, all kinds of questions come up like, well, what keeps that from going off all the time? I mean, if we really had an innate device that constantly went off, we would be a very nervous, jumpy kind of species all the time, and it would be hard to walk down the street without jumping at every noise. It is true that in certain circumstances, we are a sort of primed to think that that noise is someone. But most of the time, there are all kinds of noises that we don't pay attention to at all, right? And so when you start to refine this hypothesis, it's not so much that it's impossible, but it needs a lot of work. And as it stands, and as it's usually presented, it really doesn't explain anything. And it's rather obscure. It's very obscure.
Yeah. I think so, yeah.
There's a sort of a tendency within this kind of cognitive science to say every time a pattern is observed in human cognitive behavior, they invent a module that basically takes care of that behavior. It's a mechanism. As if, and then they name that mechanism after the behavior, right? So humans, it's true, even very small children, have an uncanny ability to think about the intentions of other people. I mean, what's uncanny is how early this ability emerges, and it distinguishes us from other species, maybe, it seems to. And so they say, well, that's interesting. Well, you know how we explain that? We have a theory of mind module. Now think about, have they really explained anything? They haven't explained anything. They've just told you that there's a mechanism that takes care of that somehow, right? But it's basically just renaming what needs to be explained as a mechanism and positing it in the brain, and then they think about an evolutionary environment. Now, this is admittedly a very sort of crude and simplistic criticism of some theories which are more sophisticated, but especially in the cognitive science of religion and literature, it doesn't get any fancier than that. And I think that the state of neuroscience demands much more from cognitive science than those kinds of explanations. I mean, there's evidence that they have to be responsible to.
¿Alguna pregunta más? Especialmente, ¿ha habido alguna sugerencia para el campo de la teología y la filosofía a la hora de interaccionar con la ciencia cognitiva? No sé si alguien tiene algún comentario al respecto. Bueno, yo tengo más preguntas. ¿Sí?
Pero cuando se ha hablado de... O sea, a veces me da la impresión de que se habla o de conocimiento, información, de estímulos,
sí,
o de estructuras internas.
Ya.
Pero claro, hay quizá otros tipos de conocimiento que no sean estímulos, o sea, representativos o intelectuales. Estoy pensando más en la empatía, ¿no? Y me quería preguntar si este campo ha estudiado también diversos grados de empatía, no solamente instintiva, sino también emocional o sentimental. Si hay un tipo de conocimiento empático, no solamente instintivo.
So the question is, have they studied many different levels of empathy, and not just instinctive sort of inferences about what the other person is thinking, but emotional levels? Now, it's largely recognized within the field that they haven't focused much on emotion, but that's changing. So it's perhaps not fair to say that it's a limitation of the field, because it's a young field and they're expanding, and they probably will increasingly address things like emotion and empathy. But I suppose that, I mean, that may answer your question right there, just to say it's on the agenda, but I think the kernel of the problem for the traditional cognitive science perspective is that in order to actually understand another person as an agent, we need to have a special system that represents them as such and contains certain sort of information about how such agents normally behave, because that information is not available to us in the environment. And I would say that rock bottom sort of foundational premise is for me not convincing, just to start there. I mean, it's the poverty of the stimulus, but the poverty of stimulus applies pretty much to very broadly in cognitive science. But it applies a lot to how they think about empathy, and so you need, if I'm to understand you, I need to have a special system that represents intentions and so forth, because I can't get that from information from interacting with you, or what I can actually pick up from you is very limited. But you know, and perhaps in this case, there is a lot of really interesting research on joint attention and social psychology and so forth that is exploring that.
Ok, yo creo que es la hora de terminar. Agradecer vuestra presencia. Bueno, había una pregunta todavía de...
Yo que lo que me parece que es, agradezco toda esta exposición, por la panorámica tan completa que has hecho. Y lo que yo me pregunto es si, por ejemplo, en los Estados Unidos, o en países donde esto, en donde toda esta, digamos, materia está más desarrollada, influye en la valoración, por ejemplo. Yo lo que tengo, el problema que veo es cómo distinguir una religión de otra en relación con su influencia en la sociedad, si se pueden desarrollar criterios que permitan dejar a unas que ejerzan lo que es propio de esa religión, o se pueden poner trabas a otras y se ve que la influencia es negativa. ¿Eso se está estudiando, o hay alguna influencia en ese sentido?
So the I think the question is if in Aristides this kind of investigation has had a particular influence on certain religions.
Could be useful for distinguishing between good and bad religions or good. Permitted religions in society or.
I think that that's the future of cognitive science of religion, and I'm not sure. I think that the most important, well, I'm not going to try to go all the way back and find it, but the most important field of research now is on pro-sociality and aggression and prejudice and so forth and all this in religion. And that research doesn't necessarily need this computational framework. And in fact, I think that a lot of it doesn't depend on that framework. People are just really interested in understanding how religiosity impacts our attitudes towards other people, basically within our group and outside the group. And there is a lot of interesting data. I'm sure you've heard of studies that show that religiosity is linked with charitable giving. It's been linked with generosity, but it's also been linked with prejudice and so forth. But all of this, if you read the literature, they're still figuring out on how to tease apart these correlations, because what's serving as the proxy for religiosity in these cases, right? Sometimes it depends on how you're measuring religiosity may give you a different reading on the pro-social effects. And I think this goes to your question, they do study, for instance, fundamentalism and biblical literalism, which is common in the United States, and whether that has a special connection to, say, outgroup aggression or so forth. And so they do differentiate, and they are working on more, sophisticated tools for differentiating. And I do think that that's the most constructive thing. I would just say that, and I think this is also changing, and maybe my critique is now out of date. It is apparent that religious discourse, if you read, at least in English, if you read about what does it mean to be religious, what is religion, it's usually someone who believes X, right? X, whatever it X is, right? And if you want to distinguish, make fine distinctions between Protestants and Catholics, et cetera, well, then you start getting really specific about what they believe, right? But in any level of description, it's always about these propositions, right? And I asked a colleague of mine in the institute who does discourse analysis with big data. And I asked her a question about this, Inez, and she said that indeed she does think that belief discourse dominates how we talk about religion, and she thinks that it can be demonstrated that there's a connection between that and sort of mistrust of outsiders or divisiveness about religion. Because if you think about it, if I believe X and you believe Y, et cetera, those are strictly incompatible, or they seem to be, whereas if I practice this and you practice that, it doesn't, on the surface of it, seem like they are conflicting, right? There is a sense in which the belief discourse, and there's been a lot of literature on this, it's been constructed in a certain way to contain religion within a secular society, because belief then becomes, religion becomes something purely private. It's just a belief that I carry around in my head. But on the same time, I think in some ways it's contributed to divisiveness among different religious traditions and so forth. So I think in terms of having more constructive things to say through cognitive science of religion, I think trying to figure out how to get beyond that discourse is one of the most important steps.
Okay. Okay. Pues agradecemos al ponente de nuevo su charla. Feliz Navidad, feliz Año Nuevo, y nos veremos el 19 de enero, si Dios quiere, en el próximo seminario. Muchas gracias.